excited to be here this morning and excited to share the word with you. And I would just like to thank Pastor Ron and Denise for giving me the opportunity. I never take it lightly when I'm able to share with you and minister with you. You know, it's not just a privilege, but it's something that I take with care and respect and honor to God. So I just want to take 1 second and let's pray for Pastor Ron for his recovery. Lord, thank you for the gifts that you've given us here in this house. Father, thank you for the trust that they have imparted to us to take over while they are getting well. Lord, we pray that you would touch Pastor Ron's body, that you would cause that healing to come quickly, that it would be manifest in his body, that any pain or discomfort would go in Jesus' name. Father, we look forward to hearing the testimony of his healing in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning, I would like to talk to you about something that has become a revelation to me. I want to talk about praise and worship. This morning, I think that by knowing God and knowing how to approach God, we can have trust in him and we can actually have heavenly worship here on this earth. Do you ever think about heaven? You do? I got to be honest, I never really did. I was too busy with life, with wife, with work, well, all these things, and I never had time to think about heaven. And it wasn't until my son Asher was born that I started to think about these things. I would come home from work, and I would sit in my chair before I had to do things around the house. And sitting in that chair, for the purposes of this illustration, we will call it my throne. He would begin to run around my chair. And my son was young. He didn't have anything to do. Every need that he had was met by me. He didn't have to worry about what he was going to eat or wear. His job was playing and napping. But when I came home from work, he was so excited to see me that he would run around my chair and he would actually sing songs. I'm so happy to see my dad. My dad's so cool. I love my dad. And that opened my eyes. And I remember distinctly looking at Renna saying, this is what heaven looks like. We're here for a very, very short time on this earth. When my son was born, my dad died 5 months later. And that kind of shocked me. And I realized that our time here needs to be purposeful. God's big into sowing and reaping. We are eternal beings. We're here bodily right now for like 70, 80 years. But what we do right now goes on for eternity. You know, when you get to heaven, you're not going to be a mindless robot. You're not going to, like, change completely. You're going to be you. You'll have thoughts, but you're not going to be bound by the things that hold us down in this world, the old thoughts, the guilt and shame and condemnation. You're not going to have any type of distractions, but you'll be able to worship God fully and trust him. So, today's message, I'm going to be talking, it's not my typical message, which is funny, it's more a collection of thoughts, kind of organized, and I want to impart them to you. So I want to give you this foundational thought before we get started, and this foundational thought runs throughout the entire message of the day, okay? So prayer is about having our physical needs met. When we pray, anytime we pray, it's about something physical in this earth. I don't care if it's about, you know, money. I need money. Fine. That's a physical need. It could be relational. You could pray for relationships to be healed. That's still a physical need because it has to do with what's here on this earth. Now, praise is our response to having those physical needs met. When we praise God, we are praising him for physically meeting those needs. When we worship, worship is only about God, and it's our trust in God. So let's clear up some misconceptions of praise. Praise is not the fast songs and worship the slow songs. In fact, praise, I'm really sorry for the video. I move around a lot. Praise isn't even about music. We use music in our praise, okay? Praise in our music is cultural, okay? And style. That's our culture and our style is not praise. Culture and style changes over time, right? If it didn't, we'd still be singing hymns. Not that there's anything wrong with hymns. I love hymns. Okay, if it still didn't, we'd be chanting, right? If it didn't, we'd still be singing arabesque quarter tone notes. We don't do that. We sing culturally relevant music to us, right? It makes for more of a immersive type of experience with God. You know, put it another way, we use projection screens. Well, 100 years ago, they used stained glass windows, right? So all of these things are not praise. They're just a means to get us to be in touch and communication with God. So God is very specific in how we approach him, okay? How we approach him needs to be careful with reverence and respect. Now, it's true that God's grace and his mercies are new and available to us every morning. I thank God that he has blessed us and that he's given that grace to me because I mess up a lot. I don't know about you, but I do. And I treat God with respect, okay? One of the things that's an illustration that's the best, in my opinion, because I'm a Bible geek. One of my favorite classes in Bible college was Manners and Customs of the Bible. And if I turn on the TV, it's going to be the History Channel. I want to learn something. I love learning about just geek facts. I'm hoping Jeopardy will call me one day. But one of the best examples of worship is in the Old Testament. And manners and custom has a lot to do with symbolism and types and shadows throughout the Bible. And you can see God's handiwork through types and shadows and symbolism throughout the Bible. It's amazing. A physical example of how to come to God, how to approach God, is the temple. And one of the first points I have, I guess you could call it a point, is that we need to come to God with awe. Psalms 2:11 says, "Worship the Lord with reverence, rejoicing, and trembling." Let's talk about the temple. The temple is the Temple of Solomon. And the temple was set up in three major parts. There was like an outer court, some translations call it an inner court. And what would happen in this inner court is that the animals would be sacrificed as people were entering into worship. So this is kind of the area that Jesus flipped the tables, right? So it's the inner court that all of the sacrifices to God are made. And as these sacrifices are made, the people are purified because the Bible says without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. So the animals had to be sacrificed. Then what would happen next is the priests would enter the holy place, the sanctuary. And in the sanctuary, they would cleanse themselves and they would begin to praise and worship God. And then further beyond that was the Holy of Holies. And around the Holy of Holies was a veil. And inside was the ark. And the ark, everywhere in the Old Testament that is mentioned represents the presence of God. So the very presence of God is behind this veil. The only person allowed into this Holy of Holies was the high priest. He was the mediator on behalf of the people. He was allowed to enter once a year on the day of Yom Kippur. Now, the high priest, he had a pretty strange getup. And it was on purpose. He wore a long robe, and on the bottom of the robe had bells. Right? And these bells would jingle as he was walking. And he had another neat feature on his getup. And it was a rope. And this rope went outside the Holy of Holies. And he would begin to praise and worship God, but he needed to be cleansed himself. And if he wasn't cleansed, God could strike him dead. And the bells would stop ringing. And everybody in the holy place would pull him out. That's pretty awesome. That takes a lot of respect to come to a God like that. Now, David wrote most of the book of Psalms. He's called a man after God's own heart. This is just my opinion. You are welcome to fact check me. But I believe that we can have a deeper worship experience than David did. And the reason is for what Jesus did on our behalf. We've been cleansed by Jesus' redemptive work. Okay? Because of this, we can now come with access to God. In the Old Testament, you came with awe. In the New Testament, because of what Jesus did on our behalf, we can come with access. Okay? 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, "Don't you know that you are the temple and the Spirit dwells in you?" So, manners and customs, symbolism, let's talk about this, because this is amazing to me that God is so thoughtful throughout his entire scriptures. What's the biggest part of the temple? Biggest part of the temple is the inner court. What's the biggest part of us that you see is our bodies. Now, what you have to do in the inner court is make the sacrifice before you can enter into praise. What do we do? What is the thing that we are constantly fighting with? Our body, our desires. We have to, let's talk about it. You don't want to work out, do you? No. But you force yourself to work out. You sacrifice yourself to work out. You don't want to get up early. You force yourself to get up early. You have to constantly sacrifice what this flesh is telling us. Right? It's a difficult thing to do. So as we begin to sacrifice our body, we are then able to come with thanksgiving and praise with our soul. Our mind is constantly renewed by the scriptures. This is the cool part to me, because in Hebrews 10:19-22, it tells us, "Therefore, brethren, having the boldness to enter the holies by the blood of Jesus, by having a living way which he consecrated through us, through the veil that is his flesh, and having priests over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, with full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water." That's a mouthful, right? But we are able to boldly enter God's throne room. I'm kind of an expert on being bold. Boldness is not arrogance. Boldness is being sure of what you know. You can't be bold in the things that you don't know about. Jesus took the place of that high priest for us. And it says in the Bible that he tore the veil from the top to the bottom. And he made way for us that we could enter in boldly. We don't have to worry that God's going to strike us dead. We've been cleansed. The scripture says that we have been purified. Our hearts have been purified. So when we come to God, we can come to him with the awe But we can come to him with the access, which is why we can have a deeper worship experience than even David did. So, there are things that tend to hold us back, though. And I have another opinion. You can fact check me on this opinion. I wish you would. In my opinion, pride is the opposite of worship. Why? Because where pride is, praise cannot be. They can't coexist together. The Bible is very, very clear, and God is very clear, that the one thing that he really hates is pride. He says it over and over again. Let's take a look at Proverbs 6:5. Everyone that's proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Even though your hands joined in hand, you shall not be unpunished. Psalm 10:4 says, in his pride, the wicked man does not seek him, and his thoughts, there is no room for God. What's the definition of worship? Worship is an act of submission. Praise is an act of submission. The Bible declares that we are now kings and priests. And when you take a look at heavenly worship, it says that the elders cast before him their crowns. A crown is a representation of authority and privilege. And God has given us that authority and privilege. But even though we have that authority and privilege, it's not just for us. We give it back to him in our praise. We lay it down before his feet. We sacrifice. It's an act of submission, coming up under, saying, God, you have done great things in me, but you are greater. The Bible talks about Satan, how he was, you know, the original worship leader. He was one of the archangels, the highest of them. And in Isaiah, we get a picture of what was going on with Satan. Let's take a look, quick look at what he was saying. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut to the ground. You have weakened the nations. Let's look at 13 specifically. I don't know if we have that, but I'll read it to you. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend unto heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend to the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. God really hates pride. Now, I'm a musician, and I've heard preachers over the years say, you know, if pride comes in, it's usually through music, because Satan's the original worship leader and he perverts music. I gotta be honest, I have never really seen anybody so blatant about their gift that they're this prideful. I just haven't. I think that pride, at least in the Christian community, it's more subtle. What does subtle pride look like? Well, subtle pride is withholding worship, withholding praise. Everyone has their reasons. I'm sure you've heard of them. I'm sure that you probably have said some of them. I know I've struggled with them. Some of the excuses are, well, if I do this, I'm going to look foolish, and I don't want to look foolish in front of my friends who might be watching. How about this one? I'm not really a singer. Or I don't know what to say. This is always a good one. Praise and worship is a personal thing, and I just, you know, it's personal. It's just between me and God. Have you said any of these things? Have you heard anybody say any of these things? Yeah, I know you've heard it, but nobody's ever said them here. You've heard other people say them. But praise is about self-sacrifice. It's what we give back to God. The Bible tells us to bring in the sacrifice of praise. So what are some ways to praise? Well, I can tell you biblically. Number one, lifting our hands. In the sanctuary of the Lord, Psalm 134, 2. Timothy 2:8 tells us to lift up our hands everywhere without wrath and doubting. We worship God with our singing. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to God, for he is pleasant and the praise is beautiful. Psalm 147. We praise him with our words. Therefore, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving him praise. We praise him with dancing. Let him praise his name with the dance. Let him sing praise to him with the timbrel and the harp. I like it because another translation says, praise him with stringed instruments. And everybody knows that Jesus loves bass the best. We praise him in the fellowship of others, not alone. It says, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praises to you. So what does heavenly worship look like? It is always, fact check me on this, heavenly worship is always corporate. The excuse, like, I just praise God at home, doesn't fly in the face of God's word. It's wrong. Praise and worship is a corporate event. What would you say to somebody or about somebody that just saved you and your entire family from a fatal accident? Think about that. If somebody, a fireman, just saved your whole family from a burning building, what would you say about that person? Praise is not always about us. It's not always, it is sometimes for the benefit of others. Okay? The Bible declares that Paul and Silas were thrown into a prison. Not just any prison. They were beaten and then thrown into the inner cell of this prison. And then it says, they began to sing and pray, and the other prisoners heard them. So, wait a minute. We're talking symbolism, right? Or at least I am. The prisoners heard them. So these guys were thrown into the innermost depths of a prison. They're having the same experiences as all the other prisoners, yet they are praising God through their circumstance. What happens then? God strikes with an earthquake. The prison doors are open and the prisoners are set free. People are listening to you. People need to hear your praise. Whatever you praise, you magnify. The Bible tells us to magnify the Lord. Okay? Whatever you magnify is where you place your worship. Now, if we're talking about praise for the benefit of others, people are listening to you. What is coming out of your mouth? Is the fact that you might have a sickness, is that sickness taking place in your words, in your actions? Are you magnifying that sickness over God? Are you magnifying lack over God? The more you magnify the situation or the problem, the more you are worshiping that problem. And eventually, that worship to the problem, that problem will become your Lord. So praise is our response to God meeting our needs. God is jealous. He doesn't want anything competing for his attention. I said earlier that our foundational thought was prayer is about our physical needs. Praise is about those needs being met. And worship is about God alone and our trust in him. Okay? True worship requires absolute trust, and it is only about God. The need for self-preservation must be sacrificed. Trust is built over time. So your faith in God is built over time in praise. As God meets these needs, we praise him. As we praise him, we begin to trust him more and more, right? God is a relational God. Ren and I, when we got together about 20 years ago, she didn't explicitly trust me with the finances. It took time for her to begin to see the decisions that I made, how I handled the finances. So it was the time that we spent together that she began to trust me. Well, this is where, when we approach God, that our trust is built. Most importantly, since worship is about God and trust in God, I'd like to take a look at Genesis 22. This is important because it's the first time that worship is mentioned in the Bible. Anytime that something's mentioned the first time, it's of great importance. And we should glean what is actually happening from it. So, when you look at Genesis 22, it says, "And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. And he said to Abraham, Abraham! And Abraham said, Yeah." This is my translation. I'm from Maine, so this is actually how I read the Bible. I know it's very weird. "Take your son, your only son Isaac that you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and I want you to offer him a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I tell you at that time." Verse 3. "And Abram rose up early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two young men with him and Isaac his son and cut the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went to the place that God told him. Then on the third day, Abram lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off." Let's stop right there. I don't know how you read the Bible, but I put myself in their shoes as I'm doing it. And I look at verse 3, there's a lot of conjunctions. That word, and. When you take a look at that word, and, if we can pull it up one more time, and, that's New King James, we're talking King James, it says, "And Abram rose up early in the morning, and saddled his donkey, and." Each time there's an and, that's a specific amount of time. One of the ands is he cut down and chopped the wood for the burnt offering. How long does it take to cut down wood and then chop it? How long do you think it actually took for this to happen? Now keep in mind, the whole time that God is asking Abraham to offer his only son, the son that God had promised him, right? Isaac was the promised son, and now God is asking him to be sacrificed on God's behalf. And what did Abraham do? He got up, and he did it, and he slugged through, and he went, and he cut the wood, and he got the guys to come with him, and he got the donkey. It took a lot of time. When we take the kids to the beach, we got the stuff like pretty much ready, and it still takes a lot of time. At any point in time, Abraham could have said, "You know what? this isn't God. God would never ask me to give the thing that he promised me, Isaac, as an offering. How many of us would talk ourselves out? I'm being real. I mean, yet, there was trust that Abraham had with God. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to go into the rest of the story, but we know that God provided a ram at the top of the mountain, right? And God was worshipped at the top of the mountain by both of them. So, that absolute trust, that self-sacrifice, is what we need when we truly worship God. So, I'm going to tell on myself. So I know that all of you are perfect and you know how to worship God and praise God. And, you know, those things that we went over, the biblical examples, you all do all the time. But I think I only truly worshiped for the first time last year. I've been a Christian since I was 7. I'm now in my 40s. And I've had God do many amazing miracles in my life and do things that have blown my mind. God used my hands to impart healing to other people. I've seen many amazing things. But I think I've always praised God. Now I know, I'm sure I've come close to worship before, but I'm not sure my trust was solely in him. And last year, a lot of you know that Renna and I moved, and we moved into a new home. And God spoke to us and told us that we were to move. So we began to prepare our house that we had lived in for 18 years. And every single project that I didn't finish in that 18 years, I now had to finish. So we were under the gun. And it was really difficult. But then on top of that, we had to get the financing. We had to watch our kids. We had to still go to work. There was a lot of pressure. We still had to pack. We still had to move. We still had to do all these things and get the house looking good enough to sell. And our church, throughout that process, was absolutely amazing. It was such a big help that everybody gave to us. And I can't name names because I will forget people and that would make me feel bad, but thank you. Well, in the process, I was not praying. I was praying, but I was not praising. My relationship with God kind of fell off because I was so focused on these things. And we just had to keep slugging away, and slugging away, and slugging away. And there was one day that I will never forget. The bank called 4 days before our closing and said, this deal is probably not going to happen. Now, I want you to keep in mind that our house that we lived in for 18 years was sold. We had to move out of this house. There's no backing out. We have to move. And I remember Asher coming into the bedroom that morning on our last day, and he was on my chest. And I remember looking at the ceiling, thinking, is this it? Is this the last opportunity that I'm going to have as a father to provide any type of shelter for my kids, any type of security? I mean, this house I lived in longer than any place I've ever lived. And I had to keep moving the stuff out of the house, knowing that the deal is probably going to fall apart. Now, you all know the end of the story because we moved into the house, but not at this time. I had to keep carrying boxes out of the house and keep carrying. And every moment, I was paralyzed. But then something happened. I had been thinking, gosh, my life came down to my folder being on somebody's desk, and they have my fate in their hands. And I thought, God, how is this possible? How is this possible, God? So I began to worship, because that's all I could do. There was nothing left for me to do but worship God. And I began singing the song that we sang, Renaissance, this morning, You Alone Are God. And as I began singing this song, something began to happen inside me. Something changed. My faith began to arise like I'd never had it before. Anything that was inside of me, any striving that I had ever tried to do, was leaving me. God was becoming magnified in my life. My problems were falling off. As this faith began to arise, I got a revelation. My faith and my fate has never been on a folder on somebody's desk. God alone holds me in the palm of his hand. God is who I trust. And as I began to praise and worship God, I began to have my trust be in him. And everything, all the times that I had praised him before, was a culmination of understanding who he is. And you know what? Something happened. My trust in him changed my thinking. And something funny happened, that this house didn't matter anymore. It didn't matter if we lost this house, because God was God, and he holds my fate. My sacrifice and my absolute trust in God is all that mattered. And I'm not kidding. It was like clockwork. When I got this revelation, I began to be like, yeah, you know what? God, I trust you. I don't care if we lose this house, because this house is nothing. You are God alone. And clockwork, the phone rang. And I got a word that I will never forget. And it said, I've got some news for you. You're clear to close. So, God always provides a ram. He always comes through. It's our trust in him that is most paramount. Our worship is all about God. Anything peripheral, houses, finances, healing, they all go away. Because what are we talking about here? We're talking about heavenly worship. And in heaven, we don't have to worry about sickness. We don't have to worry about banks closing on houses. It's always about trust, and it's always about God the Creator and who he is. Today we have a privilege. We get to take communion. And communion is one of the types and shadows and symbols that we still do. Rena, if you want to come up. We have an opportunity to take it and put ourselves into remembrance for what Jesus did for us on our behalf. We've taken communion many times, most of us, and each and every time we're to bring ourselves back to put ourselves into remembrance for what Jesus did on our behalf and the redemptive work that he did. But today, as you're taking it, I want you to remember the redemptive work that he did when he tore the veil and he allowed us to give us access, and he cleansed us, that we are able to come before God as clean vessels, that we're able to worship him and trust him freely. If you all would like to stand, logistically, if you go to the end of your aisles, to the outsides of the building, come to the front, and you can make two lines and grab the elements. Thank you for what you did for us. God, we thank you for the redemptive power of the cross. We thank you that you've cleansed us. God, we come to you in awe, but we come to you with access, with the ability to stand cleansed before you, Lord. God, we renounce pride. We want to be close to you, Father. God, we thank you that you have met all of our needs. We praise you for meeting our needs, knowing exactly what each of us individually need, Father. Lord, our hope and our trust is in you. God, we put ourselves into remembrance of you. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Let's partake. I told you that this morning I don't have the normal points and 1, 2, 3 message. The Bible tells us to be doers of the word and not to be those that look at ourselves in a mirror, reflect on ourselves, and then walk away and forgetting what kind of person that we are. This morning I would like to take an opportunity to be doers of the word. I'd like to take a moment to worship. And I'm challenging you to step out of your comfort zone in worship and praise to God. If you've never lifted your hands, I encourage you to lift your hands. If you've never danced, dance. God loves your praise. God is worthy of praise. thank you for your revelation. God, I pray that you would touch everyone here. God, I pray that you would put us in your remembrance throughout the week, Lord. God, we desire to have a closer relationship with you. God, we want to trust you with all of our lives in every area. God, don't leave any stone unturned. Father, you are worthy, and we will praise you. God, thank you. Thank you for your grace and your mercy that's new and available to us each morning. Hallelujah. Thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We have an opportunity to do this each and every time that we come into the presence of the Lord. God is a father that loves his children to circle his throne. All your needs are met. He loves you with an everlasting love. Each time we come into the sanctuary, I'm challenging everybody to come with awe, but come with access. Put off pride, and let's magnify the Lord together. Thank you.